Hello everyone, welcome. My name is Roland. The program is called Shedding Shackles. That's how I begin all my radio programs for 25 years. And I help people. At least I try to help people. And what I do is I point out errors. Okay? I point out errors. If you can see your error, see, haven't you ever wondered why your life isn't working out? It seems like no matter how much money you have or how little. Oh, sure, a long time ago when you, maybe, now maybe you're a bit older, but when you were young, the younger you were, the happier you were. When you were a little tiny, tiny child, remember how it was? Why, you leapt from bed in the morning and you were full of happiness and joy and you looked forward to a day of adventure. Okay? And then if you had a decent home, which a lot of people don't anymore, but if you had a decent home, then life was pretty good when you were a little kid, okay? And then it got rougher, especially when they put you in the terrible school system, where you were subject to peer pressure, gang pressure, academic pressure, study pressure, performance pressure, grade pressure, achievement pressure, sports pressure, see? But especially the peer pressure. See, you were put in unprotected environments. And if your parents had been really smart, wise, and had love, why? And they lived in a place where it were possible, like the United States, for example, then they would have homeschooled you. You would have been educated at home, safe from the unwholesome pressures. That doesn't mean overprotected. I'm not talking about being overprotected. I'm saying to be in an atmosphere where you can grow like a beautiful flower instead of being strangled by the weeds all around you. See? Because when you're thrown into a Lord of the Flies, remember the Lord of the Flies? Remember that famous novel? When you're thrown into a Lord of the Flies type of environment, where you have a bunch of animals, other kids from rotten homes, and you have bullying and teasing, the amount of tease that goes on in school is just unbelievable. So much so, sometimes, that you can hardly even function. And classrooms are a bedlam, many times. And so eventually you start thinking you just want to survive. Oh, sure, you get in, you find a little group that you join for support, your peer group, divide up into groups. But, and there's corruption there too. Before long, you're smoking marijuana with them and doing whatever else they do. It's always the lowest common denominator. See, instead of right people being elevated by their degraded and lowered. But eventually you start thinking, boy, I can just survive. I can just survive high school. You know, then I'll get a job and I'll go to college and so on. But then as the years went by, well, maybe when you were a young person, you were still relatively happy. Once you got out of school, then you had a job and a little freedom maybe. But very quickly, who knows what happened, but before long, there's relationship issues and health issues and financial issues, and the world seems to be to close in on you, okay, from all sides. Well, so things aren't working out. So there must be some errors that were made by your parents when you were growing up, by other authorities, and then by yourself when you grew up and tried to the tried and true path that they laid out for you. See? Maybe you rebelled against it all. So, but the point I'm getting at is whether you conformed, you became a conformist for approval and for perks, see, and for a modicum of success, the crumbs that other people throw to you and the perks that they give you for not rocking the boat, okay? So you maybe became a success, you have a good job or something, okay? But still you're not happy. Something is missing from your life. On the other hand, maybe you rebel Maybe you rebelled. See, some people usually go to extremes. One brother conforms, the other rebels. One sister conforms, the other rebels. So maybe you rebelled. So you hung out with the gang, or smoked marijuana, or took drugs, or see, you just went and lay around on the beach and surfed all day, and didn't have a job. See, things like that. You just rebelled, maybe. But even there, eventually you find you're not happy there either. So there has to be an answer. Okay, well, the answer is, first of all, your first error is that you don't know where to look for the answer. Well, maybe you sort of do, but you forgot. When you were a little child, you knew where to look for answers. You knew in your heart. See, you knew there was such a thing as good and truth, and you loved justice, and you knew there was kindness, and you knew those things were really important. Okay? But around you, you saw what? Hate, anger, tease, cruelty, confusion. People always seem to try to want to confuse you, to trick you somehow, to tease you, or to act like something is one way and then it's another way, and then they laugh. See, they fooled you, like they accomplished something. See. Well, so you sort of knew, but you forgot. But you never found it. See, they don't teach you in school. They don't teach you where to find the true answer. See, what was Adam's mistake? Adam's mistake was he turned his back on the simple way of discovery, the discovery path. See, he was on the discovery path. That's what God had planned for him, a wonderful discovery path, where every day Adam would learn more and more of the universe, more and more about God's great green earth, more and more about God. See, so many wonderful things to discover and to learn. It would have been beautiful. It would have been an adventure like Star Trek or Star Wars or Raiders of the Lost Ark, something like that. But instead, Adam turned his back on that source, with a capital S, of knowing, and instead chose knowledge. Knowledge. So, see, if he thought that if he could gather knowledge, little pieces, bits and pieces of facts and figures and formulas, and see, inside knowledge, and you know how people are always looking for knowledge. People are always looking for special knowledge of some sort. See, that they can have, that they can gather in and hoard. See, so some people study. They study, get degrees and have all kinds of facts, but they don't have any common sense anymore. See, they don't have understanding. They turn their back on understanding. They turn their back on wisdom. They turn their back on the discovery path. And instead they hoard knowledge. Other people are looking for something like they look to astrology or fortune telling or somebody who can give them some kind of a special knowledge about which team's players are injured or something, so they can bet on that team and win. See, people are always looking for some kind of knowledge, to have some kind of an edge, so that their ego can puff up with knowledge that others don't have and use it to get ahead of other people. See? Well, that's what Adam chose. But now today we are born. You didn't choose that way yourself. You were born into the fallen existence that was bequeathed to you from your parents all the way back to Adam. But unfortunately, and when you were a little child, you had your intuition. But nobody tells you about intuition. Instead, they tell you about knowledge. See, so all of your teachers and your most authorities and your professors and all, they're all talking about ambition. See, they want you to be ambitious like Adam and to study and study and study and hoard knowledge, just like Adam did. See, so they want you to fail. Adam, what happened to Adam? He lost paradise and then he died. Suffered, then he died. Okay, that's what they want for you too. That's the legacy that they, and that's what's happening to them. See, they turn their back on intuition. and they're looking for knowledge. And so now they do the same thing to you that was done to them. And for that, they get power. They get a big salary, see, and benefits and power, where they lord it over you. So they give you an impoverished existence. They don't tell you about the true lodestar, the true source, an infinite source of understanding. See, and instead they spoon feed you little bits and pieces, and a lot of what they spoon feed you is all wrong. A lot of what they spoon feed you is actually wrong. But having so, you don't know any better. But as a kid, you don't know any better. See, you don't know. You have a suspicion that there's something wrong with the teachers and the whole school system and all these people pressuring all the time, study, ambitious, you know, win. See, they want you to step all over your friends, step all over them and get ahead, claw your way ahead of them. That's what they want. See, it doesn't seem right. Well, but sooner or later, either because you resent them or you doubted yourself. See, you doubted. See, if the whole world is saying knowledge, study, 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 education, study, study, ambition, ambition, if the whole world is saying that, especially the authorities, you doubt it, but then eventually you begin to doubt yourself, and then you fall by default under their authority, and then they lord it over you. See? Then eventually all you can do is become like them. See, that's what happens. So your first error then is not, it's not that you turned away from understanding, although you did, but you know, like I said, you couldn't help yourself. You're just a little kid. You didn't know any better. So you doubted yourself. So it wasn't really that you deliberately turned from intuition, from enlightened reason, from a wordless way of knowing, from what you knew in your heart. It wasn't that you turned away from that so much as that you doubted it. See? And then you made mistakes. Well, you hated your dad, or you resented your mom, or you took drugs, and you made mistakes. And then you felt guilty before conscience, before the light, because you had erred. And so then you began to flee, then you made your biggest mistake. See, salvation is there for us all. But to grab salvation, you have to see that you're going the wrong way and yearn for the right way. But your mistake was that you, when you erred, then you began to resent the light because the light showed you for what you were. You didn't want to see, then you didn't want to admit you were wrong. You didn't want to admit you were in error. You didn't want to admit that you were becoming just like the ones you had hated. So you fled the light and perhaps even resented the light because it made you feel bad. See, the conscience makes us feel bad. That was your mistake. Okay? So that's your big mistake. So your biggest mistake right now that you need to look at is that you resent the light making you aware that you're wrong. See? So you have to see that intuition, what you know in your heart, is your friend. If you had stuck close to it, if you had abided by it, if you had trusted it and not doubted it, if you had followed it, you would have become an Albert Einstein. See, he trusted his intuition. See, he trusted his intuition. And thereby he made wonderful discoveries. He continued on the discovery path. Like when you were a little child, remember how you loved discovering things? He continued on that path for a long time. See? And being close to that good source, you would have grown in virtue, in honor, in patience. See that source from God. It's from God. And you know it as intuition, or when you stray from it, as conscience. But that source from God is a source of endless patience, endless discovery, endless enlightenment. See? Endless, all of that, courage, all the good things. It's an abundance of it, and you tap into it. You tap into it when you stop doubting it, and you stop resenting it. See? When it rubs your nose in the fact that you've made some mistakes, you've done some wrong things, resenting your dad, resenting your mom, resenting your brother, being phony with people, being selfish. See? Things like that, see? Being impatient with your kids. So when the light is there, see, if it's not there, then you just go about your little existence and hope and pray that one day it will be there for you. But when it's there, when it's there, when it's unmistakably there, in those special moments, like when your child comes up and asks you a question and you say, "Leave me alone, I'm busy," and your child rushes away crying, then all of a sudden you realize that you were impatient. See, you were selfish and impatient. You, when you see that, the light is present. See, the light is good. The light is good, and you see your own wrong in light of the good. You see your own error in light of the truth. So if you just sit still and bear that light, see, and don't immediately reach to try to make things good. Don't say, "Oh, here's $10, give your child $10, you know. Oh, I'm not feeling well today, but here's $10, enjoy yourself." See, trying to smooth things over and co-opt, placate conscience. No, don't do that. On the other hand, don't, you know, beat yourself up and say, "Oh, I'm no good, I'm terrible, blah, blah, blah." No, that's just another ego trip. See, another way of trying to rise above conscience. Just sit quietly and bear the pain of seeing you're wrong. It's kind of a helpless feeling. You see that you're wrong. You see that you can't change yourself. You are wrong, okay? And you can't change yourself, but still you don't like what you see. You regret what you see about yourself. It's that simple. Just bear that. Bear that pain, and it'll refine into sadness, into regret. And that's how you're reconciled to the light. See, you have that opportunity. Apparently Adam didn't. You do. It's different now. Maybe because Christ came. It's different. You can reconcile at any moment, in this very moment, as you're listening to me. If my words, you know, ring true, you can see the truth of what I'm saying and quietly, silently say, "Yes, you know, I'm wrong." Well, now you are actually closer to the light. See, the light, the same light that is in me is in you. The light is in you. Your mistake is that you've run from it. You doubted it. You tried to hide from it. See, you tried to make things right yourself and make yourself good without it. Now you see that you can't do that. So the closer you get to the light, the more you have those little moments of repentance, where the light repents you. See, you can't repent yourself. The light repents you. The more you have that, the more you begin to trust in that. See, the light is always there to help you. It's always there. How many times, you know, you hear a story about somebody, they pull up to a red light, and then the light turns green, but for some reason, they don't go forward. For some reason, they sit there for an extra 3 or 4 seconds without going forward, and then all of a sudden, here comes a red light runner plowing through at 60 miles an hour. If they had gone forward, they would have been struck. Would have been awful, but somehow they didn't go forward. See, there was a protection there, a protection. See, you're walking down the street and you're getting ready to go through the alley that you always go through at night to get from your evening class at local community college or wherever to your car. So you're going to go through the alley, but all of a sudden something restrains you for some reason. You just sense not to go down that alley. Something is restraining you. So you don't go down the alley. Instead, you walk along the light, brightly lit street. And you have to walk a longer distance around the block to get to your car. But you know what? Something was lurking in that alley. Okay? And you were safe. Simply by trusting in your intuition. So you need to retouch bases with your intuition, what you know in your heart. See? And it not only will it show you you're wrong so that you won't be wrong anymore. It'll prevent you from making errors It'll be a protection. See? It'll help you to see through deceit so you won't follow the wrong people anymore, wrong advice. Not only that, but it will begin to change you for the better. See, every contact with this light, this source, makes for an improvement for you. See? Then you, as you begin to change from within, mysteriously, see, you won't even sense any difference. But all of a sudden, you know, you'll wake up one morning and you'll realize now that you're more patient. See? That you're not as tense anymore. You're not always rushing. Now you move more calmly, but you get more done. See? And somehow the relationship with your partner and your kids has improved. Now you're beginning to have some wisdom and discretion and kindness and a twinkle in your eye that you didn't have before. Before you were always intense and angry and resentful and so on. See? A lot of other good things can happen. Maybe things will start to give you up. Maybe smoking gives you up, or taking drugs, or smoking marijuana gives you up, or eating too much, or drinking too much coffee or soda, or whatever it is that is not wise. All of a sudden, you just begin to effortlessly. All of a sudden, one day, you just don't smoke anymore. See, and after you stop, there's no side effects, no withdrawal, you just stop smoking. See, or you start to eat more moderately. Maybe it's not stopping altogether with certain things, but your practices are moderated. Your food practices, your work practices, your sex practices are moderated. Okay? And so this wonderful, magical thing enters your life simply by getting closer and closer to the light. And the more good things happen, the more you begin to trust in the light, and the more you want to be close to the light. See? And the closer you are to the light, the simpler life becomes, and the more good things happen. So that's why I'm here, to tell you about this, and also for those of you who begin the path of discovery, to, you know, my videos, my books, have some clues to perhaps help you see what, to validate what you're discovering when you start on the path, and also maybe point out a couple of possible stumbling blocks where people get stuck, have a wrong idea, and you know, and so I help with that a little bit, and you know, and the meditation that I have is just a little tool, a little technique to help you find the light more quickly. See, help you find it and show you how you can get in touch with it every day. Begin the day by getting in touch with the inner light and stay in touch with it. See, the meditation helps with that. See? Well, hope you enjoyed this little video. My name is Roland.